Hi, everyone. Welcome to NDE Higher Dimensions. I am Dan Kay, and our guest tonight is Ana Christina, and she's going to tell us about her near-death experience and also some other spiritual experiences she had. Ana, thank you very much for accepting our invite to share with us your amazing experience. Please briefly introduce yourself and begin telling us your story as much detail as you can.
Okay. Well, thank you, Daniel, for having me on your channel, especially if it's the first one. That's an honor. Let me tell your viewers a little bit about my background. I'm born in Alexandria, Egypt, to a Coptic Orthodox Christian family. And we migrated to Canada when I was about 7 or 8 years old. At that time, my younger brother, Steve, he was born mentally handicapped. And in Egypt, they did not really know what that was. So we migrated there to get him better medical help and diagnosis to help him out. Around 10 or 11 years old, when I was 10 or 11 years old, my father decided to take us back to Egypt for a few years. I'm one of five, so I have two sisters and two brothers. And he wanted us to learn our culture. He was afraid that when we are growing up in Canada, not knowing anything about Egypt, we would forget it and really not relate. So it was good. So we went there. And I was having a real hard time with the language, the Arabic language, because my education was English and French. So my father hired a tutor to help me with geography, history, things like that. The tutor, his name is Sam, and he was a very nice looking gentleman. And I was young. I was about 14, 15 at that time, by the time I needed a tutor. And I fell in love with Sam. And he fell in love with me. And we started dating, I guess, behind our my family's back, because in Egypt, you don't date. And then around 15, my dad took us back to Canada. So then every time I would go visit Egypt, I would connect with him. We'd go out and sneak out some dates. And then we stayed in touch. He writes me letters when letters used to be a thing. And around the age of 20, we wanted to get married. So he asked from my father for my hand. And my father liked him a lot because he appeared to be a decent guy. So, but my father said over my dead body, because Sam was not Christian. He was Muslim. And in Egypt, Christians don't marry Muslims. It's frowned on. And I didn't want to bring that to my father, who was very well-known, respected man there. And I realized I had to move on and not disappoint my father that way. It would, like, I tried to tell him, we'll go to Canada. Nobody will know about us. But it was a no, no, no. And I loved him too much to break his heart. So I moved on. Eventually, I came to California when I was about 24, 25, and I met Paul. And Paul appeared to be a nice guy. He courted me like crazy, took me everywhere I wanted, just a real gentleman. I wasn't in love with Paul, but he was treating me like a queen. Like, it was so overwhelming that I felt that eventually I will love him, because if somebody treats you like that, you fall in love with them. It didn't take long after we got married, I think it was right after the honeymoon, that I realized what I got myself into. Paul was a narcissist, man. Back then, we didn't know what a narcissist is. We had no internet. We had nothing. So back then, I felt I was alone, or it was me, because a narcissist makes you feel that it's your problem. He's always right. He's very selfish. Life is surrounded. It's around him.
Exactly.
He breaks you. He breaks your spirit. He just kind of sucks you alive, you know? And I had two children from Paul. I had Colleen and Andrew. And I was trying to make the marriage work, but it was getting ridiculous. And of course, in the Coptic church, you know, divorce back then was not, was also frowned on. But I tried counseling everybody. And one problem that got me stuck in that marriage, which I stayed for 13 years, is Paul always threatened that if I left him, he would lose his mind and would, he once said he would slit my throat and with my blood right on the walls, that I'm a whore, so that the kids can grow up knowing that their mom was a whore. Another time we were at a dinner with my cousins, and the topic of divorce came up, and I said, you know, I could hire a divorce lawyer. And right away he said, and I would hire a sniper. And everybody looked at him like, and asked him, my cousin said, what are you saying, Paul? And he casually responded that if she leaves me, I would lose my mind. And no court would hold me accountable for what I would do. So that's the hold he had on me. And I really believed he would hurt me. It got to the point where it became ridiculous living with him, the stress. I'm working as an executive. I come home, so much stress that it was just getting me sick. I finally found a good lawyer who was able to get me a restraining order. I didn't know I could do that. And right away, she got me a restraining order. Paul was out of our lives, out of our house. And I was able to just take care of my kids and just live in peace. All we wanted to do is live in peace.
Sure.
Together. We just didn't want that constant animosity over everything. You know, you tell him this is water, he says, no, this is Coke. Like stupidity, arguing about ridiculous stuff. And also money. Money was a big problem. Even though I made a lot of good money, always the tightness with money, the control over money just ruined our lives over money, over stupid little things. Back then in the 80s, it was like 84, 85. I was making $70,000 a year, which is a lot of money back then in the 80s. So it's not like I wasn't making money and he's supporting, but it's just that control of everything. We finally had our peace, my kids and I. And I brought my mom over, and I was happy, not thinking about remarrying or being with another person. I had become a born-again Christian, just got this closer relationship with God. And then I get a phone call, and the voice was Sam. Do you remember Sam?
Yeah, the first one. Yes. The one you were in love.
Yeah, the one I was in love. And he came to Florida, actually where you are, and he didn't know where I was, but he dissected California block by block to find me. Again, internet was a new thing, and he found me. We talked. It was nice, comfortable to talk to somebody caring. And but I wasn't ready for any relationship or anything. He went back to Egypt, and I stayed on. Till about 4 months later, there was a trip to Egypt. I wanted to go. My mom went to Egypt, and I wanted to go visit mom and my brothers. I thought, okay, I'll go to Egypt, and I'll give him a call. You know, I'm good. My heart is guarded. I'm not going to even consider it, but just for good old sake, you know?
Yes.
And I called him, and we met.
That makes sense.
Like, you know, And all the guards, Daniel, fell. You know, I thought I was guarded. I thought there was no bloody way I would consider falling in love with a Muslim at this time in my life when I just got so close to Jesus. But there were no guards. I fell in love again with him as if we haven't separated. And amazingly enough, he was like that perfect man that I didn't remember him to be the perfect man. I was astonished. He was a great listener. He was kind. He was a gentleman. He was just a well-rounded person. Reminded me of my father and how gracious he was. And I couldn't resist. I couldn't resist him. We fell in love. And I went back to California. He followed. I had finalized my divorce. The kids were very important to accept this because I didn't want the kids. I finally had the kids and I wanted them to be okay with him. So it was up to them. They fell in love with him. At that time, the dad didn't have time for us. He was busy at work and didn't pick them up, ignored all the custody visitations, and just was not a part of our lives. Okay. And Sam became like the father figure to them. And they're young. You know, Andrew was 6. Colleen was like 3, something around them.
They were small, yeah.
And they loved him. He would go swimming with them, biking with them, all the good stuff. So they were the ones telling me, "Mom, please marry Uncle Sam." It was like, okay, well, you don't have to convince me. That's what I want to do. And I actually didn't care about going against the church, disappointing people. I felt like I've been in misery for 13 years, going to bed a lot of times with tears on my pillow that nobody knew about, nobody could console. So now it was more, I'm not going to worry about them. I need to do what I feel is right. Yes.
You thought you deserved that.
I felt I was vulnerable, Daniel. I hadn't. Paul was a very dry man. Like, he wouldn't even come and hug me for the hell of it. Like, he would have to hug me for something else. You know, he was not a warm person. And I'm a very emotional person. So I felt this was a good match. I prayed, but I actually prayed. I said, "God, please bless us." I didn't ask God if he was blessing this. I didn't wait on God. It was more, "God, thank you for sending me this man. Please bless us." And we got married. And life was good until Paul realized that Sam is Muslim. Now the custody battles became hell. And he turned the kids against him. It was right after 9/11, where everybody had a bad idea, you know, like stereotyping about Muslim people. So it became Sam is the terrorist that's going to steal the kids and turned our lives upside down.
Yeah, all of this stuff.
It's just ugly. But we stayed together. And over time, I started seeing signs. Now, when Sam and I got married, Sam, because he came from Egypt, he did not know the language very well. I was the chief financial officer, so I was the one working as an executive. And he couldn't land the white-collar job, what we would say.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So he stayed at home, took care of the food, the kids, everything else, and I was okay with it. And I also supported his kids back home. He had 2 daughters living with his ex-wife, and I had no problem supporting them. I don't know. I was making money. I was working. I didn't have extra money. I was working and making a paycheck, but sharing it with his household. But okay. Over time,
so you were helping his family too.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I felt I wasn't like, oh, my God, he's supposed to support me. I was okay because he treated me very well. And I felt he's here away from his family, away from his daughters. The least I can do is help them, you know, go to school, put them in good colleges. Actually, they ended up being in a medical, one in medical and one in dental, like very expensive. They chose the expensive stuff. But I was okay with it. Seriously, it was okay. But over time, I started seeing flags. And then I started noticing the money, my paycheck is not completing the 2 weeks until the next paycheck. I was always overdrawn constantly. But I was making a good salary, but always overdrawn. But the accountant at work, chief financial officer, you don't want it to, when it's like a doctor who's taking care of all the patients, when you come home, you know, your kids can be dying. It's okay. I didn't want to bother with the checkbook or balance sheet. I was balancing millions of dollars. So I trusted him. I trusted him. And then it got to the point where
he had access to your money, like to the banking account, to everything.
It was both of us on the bank account, everything. And I trusted him. And he's managing the financials. And I'm working and bringing the financials, I guess.
Yeah.
What you do for love, right?
Exactly. Love is blind.
It's blind. But it got to the point now the kids are living with the dad because it got so ugly between us. And the kids were caught in the middle. And it got to the point where I could see we're going to lose the kids. They're going to go to foster home. Actually, at one point, a policeman said, ma'am, if you guys don't control this, we're going to take the kids away. And because Paul just was overboard. Every day he went, every time he had a visitation with them, he would go report the police that we beat him up or we had a gun and put it to his to their brain. We're feeding them like just crazy stuff, but constantly back and forth. And it got to the point I said, the kids are suffering. I'm not going to fight him anymore. I sat with him. I said, what do you want? You want them during the week? Fine. You take them during the week? You want to do their homework? Because he was just stuck on homework, you know? And I'll take them on the weekend. That's fine. And we settled that. But over time, he cut them off from me. So it didn't become a weekend anymore. It became, well, we can just come and visit you for an hour or two. And it just became really bad. But as the kids were growing, Colleen at that time was like 13. She started looking like me. Her dad started taking it out on her. She was not happy. I could see she was miserable and wanted to come and live with me. But she didn't want to live with Uncle with Sam. The dad convinced them, okay, if you guys want to go live with mom, go ahead, but no Sam. So it became that dilemma. The kids want to come and live with me. And what do I do? And at the same time, I don't have enough money to even support my kids at this point because I'm supporting the other ones. So I was starting to, you know, get cold feet. And I think at that point, he got insecure because he say, oh, now you have the kids. You don't need me anymore. Things like that. Like he would always do that. And when we were together, Sam never went to a mosque. He would come with me to church. We would go to Calvary Church. It's a non-denomination.
Okay.
He would, like, if I'm stressed, he would open the Bible and read it for me. So he was, but he never accepted Jesus as the Son of God. So he was convinced Jesus, okay, he's a prophet because Muslims believe.
Yes, they believe that.
Yeah, but not the Son of God. So he never accepted him that way, which was fine. I would just pray and that's it. What am I going to do? And then one day I woke up, it was a Saturday. And as I'm waking up, I'm feeling, I'm hearing, I don't know what it was, something like the Lord was telling me, whatever, what's going to happen today is not of me. And it was weird because the Lord doesn't usually talk to me, but it was just some a strong signal. What is going to happen today is not for me. And I got up, got the coffee. I'm having coffee with him. And he goes, you know, tonight I'm going to have communion at Calvary. And I'm going, why? Did you have a dream about Jesus? Because usually Muslim people, they would convert if they had like a dream usually. And yes, then they would convert. So I thought maybe he had a dream, something happened. He goes, no. I said, well, why now? Why would you want to do that? He said, why not? There's whores out there that do it. Why am I not worthy? And I said, oh boy, Sam, this is not how it works. Go ahead.
At this point, you were already like separating, or have you talked to him like, well, I live with my children and it can be with you? How were your relationship at this moment?
At that moment, I had shared with him the dilemma of the kids want me, the kids want to come and live with me, but they don't want to live with both of us. And I'm torn because I love him, you know, I loved him. But I felt I can't just dismiss the kids and continue living in my comfort. I felt I had to sacrifice if my kids, especially my kids, were miserable. So I was feeling, no, that, you know, I could continue living with him in a love affair and this and that, but my kids are suffering. So I'm going to sacrifice. And I shared with him that I need to sacrifice for my kids. And he got pissed off. He wasn't happy. Okay. And this is when he would say, now you have your kids, you don't need me anymore.
Okay.
But then the day of the communion, so I tried to explain to him, Sam, it doesn't work that way. Please do not take the communion. The communion is very sacred and you have to take it believing in it, or it can turn on you. We were brought up, no, I don't know where it is, if it's in the Bible, but like communion, if you don't take it in a worthy way, can hurt you. So I don't know if that I heard in a church or it's in the Bible. And I was trying to explain to him that it doesn't work. Please don't mess with that. Don't mess with it. And he didn't care. So I went with him to church just to see if he's going to go through it. I prayed he didn't. But at Calvary, they pass the plate. It's not like the Coptic Orthodox where the priest gives you. They just pass the plate, take a bread, and then you take the juice. And he took it. And he put it in his mouth. Usually he passes it, like for 9 years, he would pass it. This time he took it, put it in his mouth, and he's eating like no care, looking around, like nothing happened. Like I thought maybe he'll eat it and maybe he'll feel remorse, he'll feel something spiritual, you know, that something godly.
Yes, like this respectful way, knowing that it was disrespectful, especially to you.
Yeah. He did it in a very disrespectful to God, to me, like it's sacred to us. So you don't mess with it. You know, you don't have to believe in it, but don't mess with it. Just stay away from it. It's not for everybody.
Yeah, so we have to respect the other. And you two from different religions were living together for a long time, respecting each other, respecting the other beliefs. Right. So, yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, and I never imposed my religion on him. All I did was just pray for him, pray for his family. But I could never impose it. I felt if it's from God, God will bring him. All I have to do is just pray and lift him up. So that night, I came back home very disturbed that this had happened. I couldn't sleep at night. He slept like a baby. I'm in bed. He has his back to me. And I'm just, my eyes are awake. I'm looking at him lying on my side. And I'm wondering, what is God going to do? Is he going to strike him down? Something is going to happen. I keep thinking he would turn him into a monkey. That's all I came to me. Like when God's wrath comes in this. But I kept looking and I'm going, oh my Lord, what is going to happen? This is serious now. And he turned towards me, Daniel. And as he was turning, I saw his face turn into a demonic face. I had never seen anything like that. I saw that in movies. Never in my life. Like there's a movie called Devil's Advocate, And in it, people, you know, they appear one way, but they turn, or somebody else can see the demon in them. This is I saw a demon turn towards me. And then I heard the Lord saying, just turn around, stay on my side. You know, like I was terrified.
Yeah. I can imagine.
it was something
was, yes. You were seeing something was showing to you. Some energy, something spiritual was showing to you.
Exactly.
Something that was happening already.
Yeah.
On the other realm.
I thought that God brought him to me. He's a blessing. We're living together in peace. But when this happened, I realized, wait a second, this is not a blessing. Something wrong. God is revealing something, or something is being, I can't live with this man anymore. This is beyond. Like, I have to get out. It's not like I can't live. We have to get out. I'm living with a demon now. Like, that's what I saw.
It was your signal.
It was my biggest signal. Like, before, it was signs, you know, flags. This was like, you know, that's it. And like I mentioned, I was still in love with him. So, but I knew it didn't matter. I knew I had to get away. And I got on my knees and I prayed to God and I said, please remove him. Please get him out of my life. But please don't break my heart. Because I didn't want to fall into a depression. You know, when you love somebody and they leave, you're torn. And even though you know you need to get out, but you're now depressed. I need to work. I need to, you know, support my kids and stuff at that point. So I cried hard. And that day, it was like I was choosing God over him, because I saw a big sign from God, and it didn't matter that my heart would break over him, because I said, God, please heal my heart, or don't let me break. And I put it in his hand. And Daniel, surprisingly enough, over the weeks and months, my heart was getting harder and harder. And I fell out of love with him. It was amazing. Like, this guy, I was hooked on him since I was 14. I was addicted to him. And sometimes we think addiction is drugs, or sometimes you're addicted to the wrong person, to a toxic relationship or something.
Yes, yes.
And I was free from him. And that was when I told him, and he could see, you know, of course, I'm not as warm and things. And we sat down and said, let's have a divorce. Let's do an amicable of divorce, which means let's not fight over it. He agreed. We went to court. We filed it. And it was the kind of divorce, if you file it and no one disputes it, in 6 months, it's done. You don't have to go to court, no lawyers, not the expensive stuff that I did.
Easy procedure.
And that's it. Because it didn't have assets, or as long as there's no kids involved or assets, and all my money was being spent, so I didn't build any assets with him.
Good, yeah.
And then that was around December. It was in December 2008. And I remember at the courthouse, he kept saying, well, I need money. Can we include alimony? And I would explain to him that if we do that, then we can't do it this way. We have to hire lawyers and do it. But I told him, I'll take care of you. I'm not going to leave you cold like that. I will help you until you get set up on your feet. Mm-hmm. And then he said, can I stay in the house for 3 weeks? And I said, okay. I felt I'm not going to kick him out. He doesn't have a place to go. So I said, sure. During that time, I had brought Colleen, and she was living with us.
Okay.
And it was around Christmas time. It was Colleen's time to go spend Christmas with her brother, Andrew, and her dad. So Colleen went away about mid-December. And then I started feeling sick. My whole body started hurting me a lot. The worst part was my head. My head, I never had a headache like that. It was beyond a headache. It was like my head is going to explode. And I couldn't move my head. Like I would sit on the couch and just the blinking would make my head feel like it's going to explode. And I can't do anything, but I'm sitting there. Couldn't go to work, of course. And it's year end for a chief financial officer. That's tax time and year end. But I couldn't. I was very sick. And I begged him. He wasn't taking me anywhere. I begged him to take me to urgent care. Something is wrong. He finally took me there. They didn't run any tests. They said, you're probably coming down with a cold. They gave me a flu something and a painkiller. I think he gave me a shot to help the headache. And I came home. And then Sam started to give me his blood pressure medicine. And I don't use blood pressure. I didn't have blood pressure, but he did. And when I took the blood pressure medicine, my headache was, you know, being controlled and getting better.
Okay.
I had aches all over my body, but at least the head, I can function more now. So I decided I need to go to the office. There's just so much work that needs to happen. So the first week of January, January 8th, I drove to the office and I'm driving on the freeway. And as I'm driving, I'm seeing a vision. Now, I've never seen a vision. I'm not the type of person to get visions. I'm not holy, you know, like, and the vision was somebody in my immediate family. It was like a funeral. Somebody died. And I didn't see my brother, Stephen. I saw my sisters and my other brother, but I didn't see Stephen. So I assumed it was Stephen that's going to die. And I felt this was a message from God, a warning that I need to go see him. Because a year before, my mother was sick and she needed me. She was living in Egypt with my brothers, but I was in charge of this huge project, conversion at the office, and it needed to go up and live December 1st. And I would be up at night and day taking care of it. And then I delivered the project. Everybody was happy. And then I decided, okay, now I can go see my mom. I call her up to surprise her. And they tell me she just went into a coma that morning. And she never came out of that coma. And I did the wrong thing. Like, that's the biggest regret in my life, that I didn't put my family before work.
Yes, that's something that we all should think more about every day in our lives.
Because she didn't come back. But work, and then I left to go when she was in a coma because I'm hoping she would wake up. The work got done. They managed, but my mom wasn't there. So when I saw the vision about Steve, I didn't want to take a chance. I thought, okay, lesson learned. I need to go. So as soon as I walked into the office, I told the CEO, I need to go. My brother is sick. I'm going to wrap up things and go. And they respected me because they respect family. So I'm in the office meeting with my direct staff, all the accounting department, and I'm trying to delegate. And I'm and then I call Sam and I tell him that my brother is sick in Egypt. And I need to go be with him. And he says, okay, I'll be here when I come back. I said, okay, fine. You know, he even asked, well, Colleen can stay with me. I said, no, don't worry about Colleen. I'll send Colleen to her dad. And I'm just busy delegating and the headache is coming on. And I'm just holding my head so it doesn't explode. And I'm sitting at my desk and I'm holding my head tight and trying to figure things out. And I get a feeling of somebody saying, leave everything, don't think, just go home. Leave everything, stop thinking. It was weird, but it was like, I'm to drop everything and go. This was a Friday. I was supposed to leave Saturday, but when I got this order to leave, I told my staff, I'm gonna book probably Sunday, I'll be back tomorrow and we'll finish this up. And they were fine. So I drove home, and as I'm walking up to the condominium, now I hear a voice. Not like before. Before, I don't know how it was. It was like a feeling. But now, it's a voice talking to me as I'm talking to you, Daniel. And immediately, I recognize that voice. And I recognize it was the Holy Spirit. And I don't know how I recognize the Holy Spirit, because I was never connected to the Holy Spirit. I never thought about the Holy Spirit. I never got him. I ignored him totally. I didn't get it. You know, I related to Jesus. I related to God the Father. But the Holy Spirit to me was a bird, you know, that comes and goes, and not sure what it was. So I ignored it.
It was something absolutely new to you.
New and recognize it. And he didn't say, hi, I'm the Holy Spirit. No, right away he's talking, and right away you know who he is. And he's speaking loud in my brain.
When it happens, it calls you more attention because, well, it's something that you're not related to. It's something different. So generally, we pay more attention to this. And absolutely. In your story, it was fundamental, yeah.
It was, he stuck to me, but as soon as he started talking, and I'm trying to figure out what the heck is going on, and he went like this for me. Like, I am not to talk about what's happening right now. Because I wanted, like, to run to the door and tell Colleen something's, you know, it was like this. So I kept on walking to my door. Sam opened the door. And he asked me, are you leaving tomorrow or Sunday? And I said, I don't know. I can't think right now. I'll let you know tomorrow morning. That's what I said. And then Colleen came out. Hi, Mom. You know, how's your day? Yeah, you hug her. And then she runs back to her bedroom. And I went, and Sam went to prepare dinner. He said, I have dinner ready for you. And I went and I changed into my pajamas, my night clothes, which I usually do. And I'm not sure why the Holy Spirit is talking with me. And I go to the kitchen, and there is Sam. He prepared one of my favorite meals. It was the rice, of course. But in Egypt, we eat something called the French bean casserole that he makes it. We make it like with filet mignon, and it's one of my favorite vegetables to be done with the rice. And he prepared the plate for me, and I stood at the counter looking at the plate, and I didn't feel like eating. And I ended up putting the beans off my plate. I took them off. I said, I can't eat anything with tomato. It's too heavy. And I was just looking at a plate of rice. And as I'm looking at the plate of rice, I'm going, how am I going to eat this? Now I don't even feel like eating the rice. I have no appetite. And the Holy Spirit goes, child, open the fridge and get the plain yogurt and put it on your rice. And I'm going, are you talking to me? Like, what? You care about yogurt? And for me to open the fridge and put it, like, such detail. It was, what? And I said, you care? And he goes, child, I'm in every little detail of your life. And Daniel, that was strong. To know that he was in every detail of my life, and I'm discovering him now. When it's too late, I don't know what's happening. I can't talk about it. And I felt like a fool. I was 49, and I didn't even recognize or know he existed. I didn't, nothing. And here he is telling me, child, I'm in every little detail of your life. And I was just ashamed of myself. And I did what he asked me to do in a very kind voice. And I went and I got my plain yogurt. And actually, that's how I love eating my rice, with plain yogurt. That's what we do. We put plain yogurt on rice. That's the Egyptian way of eating rice. And I did that. I took my plate, sat on the couch, not understanding what's happening, but I'm quiet. And I remember he cracked a joke. He had a wonderful sense of humor, but I can't remember the joke. And I giggled. I know, could you imagine? He was so cute. And I giggled. And Sam looked at me and he said, did you stop somewhere and have a drink? Like, because who sits there and eating and then starts giggling? And I just looked at him and I didn't even want to break that beautiful communication.
Yeah, that moment, yeah.
Yeah, so I just ignored him. And I ate, and it was just a nice experience. And he was telling me that, okay, go get ready for bed. That's like the Holy Spirit child, you know. So I finished the whole rice, put my plate down. I said goodnight, said to Sam, said goodnight to Colleen, and went to brush my teeth and wondering what is happening. What is going on? I'm still, why is he talking to me? I'm in awe and I'm clueless to what's going on. And I lie down, I turn off the lights, I lie down in my bed, and I'm just thinking, wondering, and he goes, child, it's not your brother, it's you. And Daniel, no one is ready to hear that.
Yes.
No one. We go to bed assuming we're going to wake up the next day. I never went to bed wondering if I'm going to die today or I'm not going to wake up. It's just, you're not ready for it. Here I'm going to bed. We're thinking about this and that. And it's you. And when he said that, my heart was so heavy. It was like a heaviness. It just broke my heart. But I was heartbroken over my daughter that's going to wake up in the morning and find her mom dead in bed. To me, that just...
No, any parent cannot imagine it. It's...
Yeah, it's just, it's too much.
It's too much.
And here I am feeling horrible. And then he reminded me of a dream I had a few years ago. And in that dream, I was walking in a meadow with Christ himself. Like, I don't dream about Jesus, but that day I did. And it was me, it was Colleen and Andrew. And we have our arms wrapped around him, around his waist. And we're walking laughing around the meadow. And I always, when I woke up from that dream, I always wondered, how did we walk without tripping on each other's feet? Because we're three, we're not two. It was like, how did we do that? And we didn't trip. And that night, it made sense to me. I realized he's reminding me that he's got my children. He has them embraced. Because he had his arms like that while Andrew was hugging on one side, Colleen on the other in the dream, and he had them. And I was, I guess I was with them in spirit. And at that point, my heart was soothed, knowing that he's going to take care of them. It was like, what do you do? It was okay. I was like, okay, I give them over to you. Like, I'm good. And I was okay with dying, just knowing that he's going to take care of them. He's embracing them. And I told him, okay, what's next? I'm ready. And he said, oh, when I said I'm ready, he said, child, you're going to go on a journey and you'll be back and be my ambassador. And when he said that, that changed everything. Like,
that he was, said that on your dream with Jesus, Spirit that night.
Exactly. After I accepted the fact and he reminded me of the dream, and I'm going, okay. And he's saying, you're only going on a journey. You're coming back. You'll be my ambassador. And I'm going, okay, I like that much better. I can do this. Tell me what to do. And it felt great. And it was like ambassador of the Most High God. And you know what? Pride got in the way. And I pictured myself like with a big brain that I'm going to just know it all because now I'm the ambassador of the mighty God. But he humbled me. And I said, what do I need to do? And he said, I need you to stop thinking. And that was a new concept because I never stopped thinking. I don't know if anybody knows how to stop thinking. I'm an analytical person, so I'm always thinking. And it was like, okay, let me do that. And I tried to stop thinking. And I kept trying to just stop it. And I kept getting confused because I wasn't sure, did I stop? Am I still thinking? Am I good? And he was very patient. I expected him to just like smack me or something to tell me, stop thinking. It's like, but he was so patient. And then I stopped thinking and I said, I'm ready now. And he said, okay, I need you to shut your eyes. And no matter what happens, do not open your eyes. I said, okay. He goes, no, child, no matter what happens, do not open your eyes. And I said, okay. So I shut my eyes and a bright light just came into the room. A light I could see through my shut eyes, a light it's unexplainable. Like the brightness was beyond. And I felt it was God the Father. It was like, that's how it felt, like it was something so powerful that it was him. But I wouldn't dare open my eyes. And then the window on my right, there was a window in our bedroom, started rattling and shaking like an earthquake. And it started shaking and I was okay. And then my heart started palpitation. So it started with the palpitation slowly, and then it got stronger and then stronger, and it was really going fast to the point it scared me. And as soon as I got scared, the whole process shut down. Everything. The light went off, my heart stopped palpitating or doing what it was doing, and the window stopped, everything, the process stopped. And I'm going, shoot, I screwed up my death. How could I? And he just goes, no, 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 child, it's okay. This one you can't screw up. And I was like, okay, well, that's good to know. He goes, I need you to relax more. I need you to relax, child. And I said, okay. And he said, but you need now to shut your eyes and stop thinking again. And the whole process started. I shut my eyes and I had stopped thinking. I know it took a long time, about 15 minutes to stop thinking. And he reminded me again, child, do not open your eyes. And it was like, okay, I got it. No, do not open your eyes. I was, okay, this is serious. And then the light came into the room again, a beautiful presence of a mighty power. It was just incredible. And then the window started shaking, and then my heart started palpitating. Then it got stronger and it got faster, but it was okay. This time I knew the drill. I wasn't getting scared. I just kept on going, and it got really hard. I really thought my heart was going to explode. And I'm assuming, well, this is how you die from a heart attack. Like, and it was so strong, but I trusted him and I took it to the end, and then everything stopped. But I didn't stop the process, and everything calmed down. And it was good again. And then he said, child, the next step is only an annoyance. And I said, okay. He goes, no, remember, only an annoyance, child. I said, okay. And right away, I felt a woof, like, of pain in my legs, like, just came out of nowhere. All my legs were just tremendous pain, and it was in the bones. And it felt like somebody was taking a sledgehammer, and breaking my bones. That's how bad it was. But he kept saying, it's an annoyance. Child, it's an annoyance. It will pass. It's an annoyance. So when he was telling me this, I wasn't really taking in the pain and living in the pain. I was just doing as he's saying and saying, it's an annoyance, it will pass. So I kept concentrating on what he's saying to me. It will pass, it will pass. So the pain wasn't as intense as it would be because I'm concentrating on him. And then all the pain stopped and I was good. There was no pain. And I was happy that this part passed as well. And I didn't feel the pain, but I realized I couldn't feel anything else. I couldn't feel my legs, my arms, my head, nothing. And I'm like in a surprise now, or in shock, or I don't know what you call it. And I'm asking him, and I'm saying, am I paralyzed? And he says, yes, child, you are. And I'm going, no, 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 no. He goes, I'm sorry, child. And I'm going, okay, can I move my toe? He goes, no, child. And I say, oh, can I try? He goes, try. And I try, and of course, nothing. I was paralyzed head to toe. And at that point is when I heard Sam come in the room. And he got ready for bed, and he slept. Gave me his back and slept. We had a two-bedroom condo, so Colleen was in one bedroom. And even though we're filing our divorce, we decided we just sleep on it. The other side of the bed, a king bed. But I was hoping that when he came in, he would notice that I was paralyzed, and then he would rush me or call 911. Unfortunately, he didn't notice that I was paralyzed, and he went to bed. And I laid the whole night paralyzed. But Daniel, it was the most beautiful night of my life. The Holy Spirit did not leave me 1 minute. He was just with me the whole night. He was downloading things from the Bible. He was teaching me things. He was the perfect teacher. Like he was just the way he was teaching it. He showed me visions. Just a lot of beautiful things. It was just a beautiful night with the comforter. I refer to him as the comforter because in the Bible, they also refer to him as the comforter, the counselor, the Holy Spirit. So he was comforting me all night. And it didn't matter that I was paralyzed. I had forgotten the part that I was paralyzed. It didn't matter. Here I am with the Holy Spirit himself, this being that's talking to me like you and I are talking, and just an amazing, beautiful being. And then in the middle of the night, I remember I needed to go to the restroom, that's when I realized, oh, I'm paralyzed, I can't move. So I'm telling him, oh, I need to go. And he goes, go. And I said, go. He goes, go, child. So I guess I said, okay. And I went and I wetted the bed, and there was just so much water coming out of my body. I thought I'm gonna drown in it or drown Sam and maybe he'll wake up, but that didn't wake him up. And then around daybreak, I heard Sam get up. He went up, he went to the bathroom, came back, didn't notice me. Then an hour or two later, he got up. But he didn't get out of the bed. He turned around and he was patting me and saying, Anna, he's pushing me. Anna, Anna. And I'm not responding. So because I had my back to him, so he pushed me down or like turned me on my back. And he came over and he started opening one eye at a time. And when he opened my eye, I could see him, but he let go. He opened the other eye and I could still see him. And then he lifted my arm and it fell. He took the other arm and again it fell. And I'm going, okay, now he realized I am paralyzed. He's going to call 911. Well, he didn't do that. He got out of bed, came around to my side table next to me, and he took a pill and he put it in my mouth. But now I'm paralyzed and my teeth are clenched. When you're paralyzed, that's how it goes. So he kept grinding the pill in my teeth, and it tasted like Xanax. It was very bitter. And I'm going, why is he giving me Xanax in the morning? Like, this is crazy. I'm already limp. And he kept doing that. And then he took a mint and he put it in my mouth. But again, because my teeth are clogged, shut. So it just stayed in my mouth. And I'm really thinking, wow, this guy is taking care of a lot of details, trying to make me smell nice. My mouth must have had really bad breath, that he's giving me a mint before he calls 911. And then he takes my arm and takes off my gold watch and my jewelry, and he puts them away. And I'm wondering, I'm going, okay, maybe it's because so I don't lose them in the hospital. Then he starts taking off my clothes. And I'm going, okay, now he's changing me to dry clothes before he calls the ambulance so that I'm nice and clean.